Hello, everyone, and welcome to the seventh webinar of the Japanese Studies and Antiracist Pedagogy Project series. My name is Rachel Willis, and I am a co-coordinator of this project along with Sophie Hasuo, Harrison Watson, and Professor Reginald Jackson. Before I introduce our speaker for today, I'd like to briefly explain the format of this event and give some announcements. Your microphones and cameras have been disabled. We invite you to submit questions during the lecture through the Q&A function at the bottom of your screen, and our moderator will try to get through as many of them as possible after Dr. Kennedy's presentation. As for announcements, next Thursday, June 17th, will be our final JSEP webinar. This talk will be given by myself, Sophie, and Professor Jackson, and is entitled Fugitive Planning and Potentials for Study, Lessons from the Japanese Studies and Anti-Racist Pedagogy Project. You can find the registration link for that event on our website, as well as in the chat. In case you're new to the series, the Japanese Studies and Anti-Racist Pedagogy Project, which centers graduate students and faculty of color as key partners and co-organizers of this intellectual enterprise, is designed to develop a forum for discussing and promoting anti-racism within the field of Japanese studies. The project's broader aim is to enhance awareness and quality of teaching related to diversity, equity, and inclusion issues within Japanese studies, with an explicit emphasis on anti-racist pedagogy as the basis for public-facing humanities research and professional development for graduate students. That said, it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker for today, Dr. Mika Kennedy, visiting assistant professor of English at Kalamazoo College. Professor Kennedy received her PhD from the University of Michigan and her Bachelor of Arts from the University of California, San Diego. Her research focuses on Japanese American incarceration, eco-criticism, and Indigenous studies. Her current book project, Crossed Wires, Japanese American Incarceration and the Environmental Frontier, examines how narratives by incarcerated Japanese Americans reimagine the environment as an alternative space of being and belonging. Additionally, Dr. Kennedy curates a public-facing exhibit entitled Exile to Motown, Japanese Americans in Detroit, in partnership with the Detroit area chapter of the Japanese American Citizens League, which will open on July 17th at the Detroit Historical Museum. Dr. Kennedy has been the recipient of multiple awards and fellowships from the Mellon Foundation, the Western Literature Association, the Japan Foundation, and more, and was recognized with the Scholar Activist Award by the University of Michigan in 2019. Her book chapter, Japanese American Incarceration and the Turn to Earth, will appear in the forthcoming Cambridge Companion to American Literature and the Environment from Cambridge University Press later this year. I've gotten to know Professor Kennedy as a member of JSAP's Feminist Reading Group, which met during the 2020 to 2021 school year. And as a graduate student and a Detroit native, I'm continually inspired by her engagement with communities in Detroit and other parts of Michigan, and her commitment to making her work accessible in spaces outside of academia. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Mika Kennedy, whose talk is entitled Pedagogy for Solidarity, Teaching Japanese American Incarceration and Social Justice.
All right, thank you so much, Rachel, for that really kind of flattering introduction. I'll try to live up to it today. And thank you to Sophie and Rachel and Harrison and Dr. Jackson for all the work that they've done putting together all of these JSAP events, which have been just uniformly fantastic. And I have learned so much from them. And I'm excited to bring some kind of small contribution to the collective knowledge that they're building through this workshop. So I'm going to go ahead and start my PowerPoint. So bear with me for a moment here as I get that set up. But as I do that, I wanted to go ahead and talk a little bit about the title of today's presentation, which is Pedagogy for Solidarity, Teaching Japanese American Incarceration and Social Justice. And I wanted to name in particular that the title Pedagogy for Solidarity is in reference to the Nonviolent Direct Action Organization Tsuru for Solidarity, which is interested in thinking through and working with kind of the moral authority of Japanese Americans who had been incarcerated during World War II in thinking about kind of the carceral state and issues of racial justice in the present day. And it really having done work with that organization and guided the way that I wanted to put together this class and thinking about how to bring a kind of college course and reach outward and make connections beyond our Zoom room, as this course was taught in spring of 2021, so we were entirely on Zoom. And when I think about the phrase pedagogy for solidarity, I see the horizon of that as kind of being about courses that have this robust community engagement component, that have institutional support for that kind of work, and that have had time to develop these sort of ongoing relationships with the communities that they're interacting with. At the same time, I also want to note that this was my first year teaching as an assistant professor, and I am contingent faculty, so don't necessarily have the kind of time and resources to yet do that work. So what I really wanted to focus on today is those sort of those beginnings, right? And being able to start and come into this work wherever you may be, whatever your resources may be. And also acknowledge that there are lots of kind of people who are likely in this room who are listening for all kinds of different reasons, who are at different stages in their career, are in different disciplines or at different types of institutions. So I wanted to start by naming the learning context that this class that I'm going to be focusing on is coming out of. And so I teach at Kalamazoo College, which is in Western Michigan in the United States. And it is a private, fairly selective, small liberal arts college. And one of its primary draws, from what I've gathered from our students, is its emphasis on study abroad and the different sorts of kind of resources around the idea of kind of international connection. And it seems very core to why students choose to study at Kalamazoo College. Kalamazoo College is also in the quarter system rather than the semester system. So there's 3 10-week terms. And for this class in particular, it met Monday, Wednesday, Friday for 75 minutes apiece. So unlike my quarter system that I grew up with at UC San Diego, there is a lot more contact hours per week for this class. And that kind of allowed us to do some of this work even on a 10-week system. The class that I'm talking about specifically is part of a series called Reading the World, which is housed in the English department. And it is a 100-level series that's really invested in kind of taking a deep dive into a particular topic and learning about it through looking at literary texts and developing skills in writing and analytical thinking. And for the most part, people who take Reading the World are non-majors, though it is one of the kind of required pieces of the English major as well. And overall, it tends to be mostly first and second year students with a couple of juniors and your one or two seniors who are taking it as sort of their passion class at the end of their college career. It's also a fairly small class and is capped at around 25 students. And I think this quarter I had exactly 25 students. And I have no expectation that you will be reading all of the text on the slide. I recognize that it's quite a bit. It is basically the text that was part of the course description listed on the syllabus that my students received. But I'll go ahead and summarize it really quickly so we have a sense of kind of what this class is that I will be talking about and focusing on today. And so my version of the course in the course catalog, Reading the World, Social Justice, focuses on Japanese American incarceration. And the overall course really has this aim of looking at the topic of social justice from a literary perspective. And so in thinking about how I wanted to do that, I decided to think or to focus on narratives of Japanese American incarceration, but specifically their afterlives in sort of our contemporary moment, in order to kind of thematize this idea of social justice, right? And to be able to think about history, not as being purely history that's kind of been cordoned off into learning about the middle of the 20th century, but also sort of bringing those ideas and those voices from these kind of historical contexts into conversation with additional and ongoing histories in order to kind of build out what those narratives mean in the broader context, for instance, of settler colonialism and Indigenous sovereignty, or of even transnational histories and histories of immigration in the United States, as well as thinking through, you know, racial injustices in the United States and the carceral state. And in bringing all of these things together, I wanted to go through a little bit about how I want to break this all down for today. And so I'm going to go pretty quickly through kind of my imaginings as I'm setting up this course and figuring out how I want to kind of honor the idea that it's titled Reading the World Social Justice, honor the idea that it is invested in an anti-racist pedagogy and what that means. And then spend the bulk of this presentation talking about how students actually engaged with this course, because I can talk however long I want about what theoretically this class will do, but ultimately at the end of the day, what really matters is how my students actually use the class and what sorts of kind of additions and changes we made to it together. And so that portion of the presentation will draw very heavily from work that my students had volunteered to be part of this presentation. Some of them chose to be named, some of them chose to be anonymous, and a few did not fill out the survey, so do not appear in this presentation. And then I wanted to close out by reflecting on some of the kind of key challenges, investments, and takeaways of having taught this class and gone through it with a group of students, particularly in the 10 weeks that we all just lived, in order to kind of build that out into our Q&A session. So without further ado, let's go ahead and talk a little bit about building the course. And again, none of this is prescriptive in any way. It's really just me thinking about my experience of being in the classroom and teaching, and hopefully allowing some kind of reflection on what your own teaching practices are and what of this might be useful for your particular context. And so I wanted to begin by thinking about the term anti-racist itself, because it's something that has kind of exploded in usage in the last 13 months, shall we say, even though, of course, it was part of discourses long before then. And thinking about the particular meaning of kind of what this term means, what its aims and goals are, what its investments are, I've found a framework by Whitney Peoples, who works with CRLT at the University of Michigan, really, really useful. And so we were thinking about the distinction between inclusive pedagogy and anti-racist pedagogy, not in the sense that they are in any way at war with one another, but in the sense that you really need both in order to kind of fulfill the work of what an inclusive or anti-racist pedagogy is intended to do. And so thinking about inclusive pedagogy is really focusing on kind of identity and the identities of students, the identities of individuals, whereas anti-racist is also kind of really focused on naming these structural inequalities in order to begin the work of reconfiguring them or restructuring them. And to think of that work as being a process and something that is intended not only to structure the content or even the behaviors within a classroom, but also to be able to be transportable and transferable to situations outside of the classroom. And so you are likely familiar with the term backwards course design, but I feel like this is a really useful place to start when thinking about how to imagine a course with anti-racist pedagogy in mind, because it helps you get all the building blocks out in front of you and also reminds you that this sort of work needs to be done at every level of thinking about what a course is. And so what I did when I was envisioning this class is to think about what I wanted that classroom to look like. And I mean this in the literal visual sense. Like, if you close your eyes right now and envision the classroom that you want to walk into in fall, what students are in the room? What are they doing? What do they have in front of them? What are they engaged with? How are they treating each other? And to spend some time with that visualization gives you a sense not only of what your class is going to look like as a syllabus on paper, but what you want it to be kind of in this very embodied and imagined way. And from there, what I like to do is then think about how to articulate what those learning goals are in words, and what assignments and activities will support those learning goals and be really directly connected to what you want that course to look like. And only then, for me, do I begin thinking about what readings will support these goals. Not because the reading and the content of a course is like the least important thing, right? But because there is an infinite number of really excellent texts that one might study in a course, and this can help narrow that down and really kind of, in fiction they call it killing your darlings. You're like, oh man, really like that book, but does it belong in this class? That's the important question here. And so it allows you to focus in on what readings are going to be the ones that for this particular class you've envisioned will best help the learning goals of the course. And so again, this is a set of slides that I'm not expecting anyone to read the full of. It's just a visualization of what I ended up coming up with in terms of the concrete learning goals that I wanted to focus on in this class that I was developing. And it goes back to this question of anti-racist pedagogy, because I wanted to make sure that I was thinking about the process and about opportunities to restructure thought, restructure practices, and how to bring that into the learning goals in addition to or in line with the content goals that I also had. And what I decided that in addition to kind of the named goals of the Reading the World series and of learning about Japanese American incarceration that I iterated in the course description, to also want to focus on two things in this class. Building a discussion environment because of the particular challenges of that on Zoom with a student population that kind of chose their college based on a strong desire to not be on Zoom, as well as this process of metacognition or reflection and really focusing on the thinking about not only what you're learning, but also how you're learning it and why you're learning it. Because again, this is transferable to any learning context, but particular to this spring at the end of a very long, very virtual year, and very pandemic-y year in general, to emphasize this practice of reflection and try and get out of the automatism of Zoom and just sort of staring at the screen and being in survival mode, right? And to really think about the why, really think about what you are doing instead of just kind of tunnel vision doing it to get it done. And so this is a slide that we began the class with on day one and thinking about the terms of the class and what they mean. This is a definition, though by no means the only definition of what social justice is, and is in fact one that was critiqued by one of the boyfriend of a student that I had in class because of its focus on analysis only and not necessarily actions taken therein. But to think about this term and to emphasize the fact to my students really early on that this class is not like how to do activism. It's not even a class necessarily about all of the discourse that kind of inheres in this idea of social justice, but it is an opportunity to think with this general idea and think about what framework it offers these narratives or historical narratives that we are studying specifically. And so in trying to make that transition from the general course title into the specifics that we were going to be studying, I offered this kind of diagram and thinking about how that framework might help us find connections between these perhaps seemingly disparate topics and to be able to consider them kind of meaningfully in relation to one another. And I won't talk too much about this right now, and we'll get into it a little bit later. And again, in thinking about the desires for this course, I also sent them this slide at the beginning of the class to kind of emphasize the fact that we will be really focusing on our discussions within our class and also sharing them outwards, having information shared to us by those outside of the context of our class. And these wonderful speakers are all great friends and also excellent kind of parts of what makes Sudu for Solidarity an organization that kind of really jives well with the content of the class that I was creating. So again, day one, thinking about the types of participation, what that discussion in class would look like, going back to thinking about those learning goals. It was really kind of emphasizing that there were multiple ways of participating in class, not necessarily just, you know, speaking synchronously, but also finding ways to engage in different ways and to kind of bring in alternative possibilities for course engagement for those who might not feel as comfortable or as able technically to participate in real time in class. We also talked about the types of coursework that would go into kind of meeting our learning goals, right? And so for this class, what I really wanted to emphasize was this practice of being experimental and exploratory and using the kind of time that we had in class to make mistakes, to try things that we're not sure about, and to divest it of this idea that if you're going to say anything, it better be good. But instead, if you're going to say something, make it something that will start a conversation, make it something that is an honest question that you want to learn more about, and have that be a mode of engagement rather than needing to come to class already with your thesis just like down pat. I also emphasized in our other main type of coursework, the idea that what is talked about and what you're learning in your coursework is intended to be shared outward. And I'll talk a little bit more about these letters later, but the primary written work that my students did for this class was letters that were sent out to audiences of their choosing. Both of these would ultimately culminate in their final group project, where they were polishing their ideas from their exploratory labs and bringing them into conversation with some kind of thing that they still wanted to learn more about and that they wanted to take ownership of at the end of the class. And so this is just a scattershot of the readings that we did in order to kind of bring all of these assignments into conversation with the topic at hand. And really what I wanted to demonstrate here with this slide is that it is intentionally tackling a broad range of different genres and different types of engaging with these narratives of Japanese American incarceration, because it is a 100 level class and is designed to begin getting students more familiar with the different types of texts that they might encounter and the different ways of approaching these texts. So we have some podcasts, we have some pamphlets contemporaneous to the 1940s, we have some academic texts, we have a graphic novel, things like that. All of the texts that I chose for this slide are things that come up in the second section of this presentation. So we'll talk a little bit more about how the class was engaging with these later. And so here we are at course policies, which I know is just a thrill-a-minute topic. but in all seriousness, they are vitally important. At the same time, I recognize that it's probably a bit more beneficial to think through course policies at kind of an individual pace and to read and reflect on them. So I really wanted to narrow this down to two things. And it's the idea of making these course policies as transparent as possible, and in really driving home the way that they are connected once again to the learning goals, and constantly bringing the focus of the class and how one might experience it back to this idea of process and of structure or restructuring. And so the first thing that I wanted to emphasize is the reflective nature of this class, and to kind of be able not only to reflect on course material, but here on day one, to reflect on the expectations of the course or the way that one might inhabit the course. And so my students did an asynchronous scavenger hunt of the syllabus, where the idea was to read through it, to respond to it, and to think about what things kind of most stood out to them and what most seemed most in line with their own learning goals. And it helped kind of engage with these course policies in a way that's different than like trying to figure out if the class has a late work policy at 11:59, the day an assignment is due. And so you see my student Chris kind of really invested in this idea of kind of emphatic reflection. And again, kind of emphasizing this idea that participation comes in many forms, and being able to think through the expectations of participation, how one might individually choose to fulfill that in class. And so we have my student Maria thinking about kind of the way that she tends to participate and what the really kind of end goal of that is. And of course, having the scavenger hunt and thinking about course policies in detail in no way kept students from not knowing certain things about the class, and that is expected and fine. But it does help begin setting that tone, begins help orienting students to what this classroom looks like, particularly when this classroom is their bedroom at home and their 7-year-old brother is in the other room trying to do Zoom third grade. And this is just a really quick reminder slide. Again, you don't need to expect to read anything on this slide, but it's a slide from our lecture slides in class, returning at the middle of the term to these learning goals, to these course policies, kind of refreshing that framework and reminding students that not only does it exist, but that it is flexible and can change based on their feedback and what is and is not working for us as a class. And so I wanted to quickly go through what an example of starting out might look like. Because particularly in a 100 level course, there's a huge range of experiences in the classroom. And I wanted to make sure that there were a number of different activities that were really focused on establishing some baseline of information and of interaction that we could use to scaffold the rest of our interactions together moving forward throughout the term. And so I think about this beginning period of the class as kind of moving the intention of those course policies into the practice of what happens actually in class. And so the first thing that we did was have a conversation about what makes people feel ready or excited to contribute to a conversation. This was a short version of establishing discussion guidelines for the course, and was really particular in its language, in that it's not what makes you feel comfortable necessarily to contribute to a conversation, because there will be and should be uncomfortable conversations or things that you are afraid to put into the room or nervous about, but can still find that willingness to speak to it. So what makes you feel ready or excited to contribute? Is the framing there. And the way that I did it in this class was to link it and begin linking it with kind of our course content. So we read this with a pamphlet called The Power of Words, which talks about the difference between terminologies in terms of internment camp or relocation center or incarceration camp, and what the connotations of each word are and what the kind of recommended usage of these terms are. And so in being able to think about what makes for a ready or exciting conversation in our own class and why the power of words or interactions might have such an important effect on the way that conversation goes was an opportunity to link kind of content and process in recognition of the overarching goals of our pedagogical project here. Another activity that we did was based on one of the podcasts that we listened to. And this one was really intended to get people loose, get people feeling willing to contribute things that didn't necessarily have to be like the dissertation that they have now written about the class content. And the podcast was talking about the different sort of aesthetics that came from three photographers that were taking documentary photographs of the incarceration camps. And so this activity was designed to reinforce the sort of differences that the podcast was thinking through by putting slides up and having students first observe and see like what they noticed about the picture, and then make guesses as to which photographer they thought had taken it. And it was, they had a pretty good time with it, but also was an opportunity to see the places where these very obvious frameworks began to break down, and perhaps photographs that really fit the models and the structures interspersed with photographs that were a lot harder to place in terms of who had taken it, and to begin working with this idea of kind of interpretation, recognizing when knowledge is incomplete and what one might still do when you don't feel like you have the full grasp of the situation, but want to work towards learning more. And so the final thing we did in these first two kind of introductory weeks of the class was the first of our lab experiments. And it began with a warm-up where I asked students to pick an object that was within arm's reach and to do a little bit of guided reflection about it. And so thinking about if this object were acquired by a historian who had been tasked with telling your life story, what would this object be able to tell about you? And what things would this object leave out? What would not be part of that history? And this was intended to kind of scaffold onto a continuing conversation that we've been having about material culture and telling history through objects and the immense storytelling power that they have, as well as the things that may end up being left out of narrative when there is no object to kind of anchor them to. And to begin thinking about that in terms of the readings that we had done for that week, where we were looking at a project called the 50 Objects Project, which looks at specific objects from families who were incarcerated and kind of tells the oral histories behind those objects, as well as a prose poem by Brandon Shimoda, which is thinking about kind of the afterlives of incarceration and sorting through objects when one is the descendant of someone incarcerated and the histories are incomplete. And so what the groups were tasked with doing together is to choose an object and to choose a portion of Shimoda's poem that they wanted to juxtapose and think through what relationship, what ideas come out of that juxtaposition. And this group was initially like a little bit deer in headlights about the entire thing. They weren't sure what to do, but in thinking through their object and what was important to them about looking at this object, they ended up alighting on a phrase from Shimoda's poem that is talking about, "I am worn, I'm tired of their histories." And the reason they chose this juxtaposition was because of the multiple meanings of the word worn and thinking about the kind of wearing of telling or inheriting histories, but also the wearing of this garment and what it means for it to hold all of these signatures upon it. And this is really the mode of experimentation that I wanted to cultivate in our class in order to get people feeling a little bit more loosey-goosey and feeling a little bit more kind of willing to not have to be right about something, but to want to try something new, even if it ends up not being their favorite thing, or even if it ends up being something that they want to change later. And this is reflected in all of these sort of day-to-day mundane tasks of this class, which I want to get into now, where we're talking about like how a discussion might be run with these ideas in mind. And so for this class, because I wanted to privilege both synchronous and asynchronous participation, there was a category of assignments called discussion leadership, the majority of which could be completed asynchronously, where a student would volunteer for the day to come up with our discussion questions. And some of these were very analytical. Some of them were interested in close reading. Some of them were interested in thinking about one's own positionality. And some of them were very honest. And like, you know what? There's this line from this Brandon Shimoda essay, and I don't understand what it means at all. Can we talk about it as a class? And to see where we might go with just pure and simple, here's a line. Someone please tell me what it means. And so these are class notes that an anonymous student took of that conversation. And being able to look at a text and start with a very mundane seeming question, but then to really get into it. And the conversation ended up focusing on this idea of being charged with disclosure, because students had a lot of different interpretations of what that was supposed to mean. And I think the reason the conversation went in this direction and got so into it in this way is because it is not the first piece of Shimoda's that we had read. This one was a more traditional essay, but having known him also as a poet, people were very invested in focusing on the particularity of phrasing in this essay. And so in thinking about this idea of being charged with disclosure, they came up together with some really interesting different ideas that I know personally I would never have come up with on my own. And so being able to ask this question of just like, I don't understand what this man is saying, and then to have not only really interesting answers come out, but multiple, and to realize that there's not necessarily one thing that he might be saying, I think was really important to that process of experimentation and being honest about where the blanknesses might be. And kind of to follow up with that, for all of these conversations, students could also volunteer to be the person who would synthesize the conversation and take a little bit of extra time after class, in the evening after class, to reflect on what we had talked about that day and what their most important takeaways were. And to kind of honor the idea that the conversations that we were having weren't limited to those 75 minutes, but could be synthesized and could be brought into future conversations. It's also often an opportunity for students who have been quieter in class, because they're like, oh man, this conversation did not go where I thought it was gonna go, to share some of the ideas that they did have, but did not feel had room in the space of our synchronous discussion. So these are some kind of strategies for creating a conversation that extends across class periods and builds throughout the term. And I wanted to quickly go through a couple of other just sort of class activities. As you know, everyone's got their little toolbox. These are not groundbreaking, I would say, but have been really useful. So thinking about ways to kind of preview a discussion that we might be having. So in an asynchronous session, asking students to think about a text in a way that they might not have otherwise. This particular text was taken from a historical document, and it was a short story that was published in the style of an old-timey magazine in that it was printed kind of murkily and a little bit hard to read. It was something that existed across multiple pages where there would be other articles interspersed within the story. So they'd have to page through the entire magazine in order to get to each piece of the story. And to think about the reading in that way and the approach in that way and what that kind of also added to one's experience of the text, in addition to attempting to sift through what the actual plot of the story was and what kind of the more traditional kind of literary analysis of that plot might be. Also trying to use sort of opportunities for anonymous collective information gathering. For this particular assignment, they were put into small groups and asked to begin parsing through some of the information that they were learning, because it was a lot of very new information about a topic that most people had absolutely no experience of. If you look carefully at this slide, you will notice that some of the things in this Venn diagram are not technically correct. So it was an opportunity also to be able to go back and to move things around, suggest different positions or different phrasings without necessarily calling someone out and being like, who's the person who put this post-it note here? But to reserve time even in a literature class for the kind of basic facts of what we are learning ultimately ended up being kind of very important in being able to move from the fact-gathering phase into the analysis phase, if we want to be fancy about it. These sorts of assignments in thinking about how to pick up from previous threads were also really important. So in this slide, which again, no expectation whatsoever that you will be able to read the tiny text in its multiplicity here, was an asynchronous assignment that was thinking through something that someone had mentioned in their post-discussion synthesis and bringing that into class in the next section. So a student was talking about how we'd been using this word solidarity a lot, and we needed to spend a little bit more time to think about its meaning and to think about its connections to Indigenous movements and history in something that we'd been talking about. And so having all of these different moments for reflection, also were able to then kind of piggyback off of those and build time into returning to topics that needed a little bit more time and that could be driven by kind of students naming these absences in our conversations and wanting to, you know, slow the pace down and return to them and for them to have that authority to do so. And I wanted to focus for this section on just thinking a little bit more about the asynchronous components of this class, I guess, in the sense that I'm not a big fan of asynchronous because I'm very type A and I like to be in conversation. I like to know what's going on as it's going on so that if anything needs to be redirected, I'm there, but needed to step back and be a little bit more hands off and allow room for experimentation. So these asynchronous labs were helpful in that regard. And so for this one, the challenge of the assignment was they were in the midst of reading a difficult primary text, the aforementioned kind of short story that was interspersed in a historical document, as well as a difficult theoretical text. And what I wanted to be able to do with this asynchronous assignment was to zero in on manageable chunks of it and to spend some time at one's own pace, really thinking through one specific aspect of a very complicated text in the hopes that others would focus on other pieces and that collectively we could build a bit more understanding of, again, this difficult text. this text was when Love's racial unsettled solidarities. And it had a lot of terminologies that some students were familiar with in terms of kind of settler colonialism, racial hegemony, and a lot of terms that most students were very much unfamiliar with. And so it was an opportunity to puzzle through some of those. And so my invitation to them for this lab was to choose a key term, whether that be racial hegemony or something a little bit less theoretical, but no less important to the text, like the idea of grief, and to, in their own words, describe how that term, how they see that term being used in Love's article. And then to think about a quote from our short story that might benefit from being in conversation with that term. And so what my student Elliot did here was think about Love's usage of the Americas and it not being a kind of Anglophone spelling of America and what that might mean and what it might be doing in relation to, you know, this US-centric, US authority in the short story that we were reading. And this piece was really, really interesting because it was doing so much with the ideas of the text, even if kind of the exactitudes of it were not necessarily entirely correct or entirely fleshed out. And you can see in a student's comment on the side that she was engaging with, you know, this, some of the things that could be further fleshed out and being able to have that conversation even asynchronously, I think was really valuable. And kind of the goal of these experiments, right, is honestly to be wrong and to move and to kind of gain from that. And so in kind of reflecting on these labs, I'll go quickly through this slide, but it was again, an invitation and a reminder that there are things that you will be able to feel really comfortable with ideas, and that we can honor that while also being kind of equally appreciative of the ability to name the parts that are most confusing and to be able to articulate exactly what was confusing about an article that you're still not quite sure about, like my anonymous student does at the bottom of this slide. Instead of saying like, wow, this article is real hard and I don't understand any of these theoretical words, they're able to say that in thinking about Love's idea of the racial tense, they weren't sure whether it was about the relationships between minoritized populations or the situations that caused these relationships. And we were able then to build off from these reflections and continue those conversations as we moved into different texts and as we began applying some of these kind of self-directed definitions. And so as we kind of come closer towards the end here, I wanted to talk about this idea of sharing information outward and what the aims of sharing information beyond the classroom were. And so the main writing that my students did for this class were letters that they were invited to think about in terms of someone that they wanted to be in conversation with about the topics that we were talking about in our class, what specifically they wanted to share, and how they could best convey that information. And so that's another way of thinking about audience, argument, and genre. And so very briefly, some examples of where students took this. My student Anna chose to write to her younger sister, who I believe is about 11 years old and really interested in art. So Anna chose to engage her sister in conversation about a graphic novel that we'd read by offering a close reading of one of the pictures and thinking about sort of how art was telling a story in this way. Another anonymous student chose to write to her father And this letter was really interesting, I think, because it began as a conversation that she had had with her father about whether or not Asian people existed in Mexico and lived there. He was convinced it was not true and discovered through Googling that it was. And she's like, well, you know, I told you that. You don't want to trust your daughter? And so writing a letter about this kind of conversation that they'd had and being able to put it into conversation with, you know, transnational histories of immigration that we've been learning about, and to connect it to her own family's personal history and to be able to kind of name the proximity to her father's own town and his own experiences growing up, and to use that as sort of the jumping off point for, you know, information sharing. And so students, after having written these letters, engaged with them in two ways. The first being kind of reading each other's letters and thinking about what sorts of ideas kind of came to the fore for them. And here we have student Greta talking about specifically this idea of how to convey information to a particular audience that you're attempting to have a conversation with, and what sorts of kind of argumentative moves that takes, or what sorts of choices of genre that takes. The second way of interacting with these letters after they had written them were in their reflections, which took on one of two forms. Is for each letter, they could either respond to a comment that a peer or I had left them, answer the questions, kind of continue that conversation. And we see in this slide sort of some of those examples of responses, and being able to, on my part, kind of touch base with each student and to flesh out some of the ideas or to ask questions about what they were talking about. So in the first one, she's responding to a question that I had asked about kind of this idea of rebuilding Detroit. And in the second one, my student is responding to an observation that I had made about her piece, where she was talking about abolition and sort of talking about it in terms of being something that's disrupting the past or being something that's making something new and looking forward. And I asked her to talk a little bit more about that. And she pushed back against the way that I was framing her essay. And she's like, no, it's not either or. It has to be this ongoing thing that's taking both into account. And I chose that to kind of point out because all of the assignments in this class were purely completion based. And so if you did all the assignments, you would get a B in the class, and to get an A in the class would be kind of engaging in these reflections. So it was not a question of being able to defend something for a grade, but to really be able to kind of forward the ideas and the conversation that we were in the middle of having. The other option people had was to kind of tell a little bit about the conversation that they had had with their letter recipient, which often resulted in sort of these cross-pollinations where students were writing to people who were then making their own connections to the information being provided, and engaging in something that was kind of dialogic, right? Where my student was sharing information that they had learned and the recipient was learning from it and also sharing kind of additional connections that they were making and allowing us to bring those as well into our conversation. And so the bottom example of these reflections, one of my students addressed one of their letters actually to President Biden, and they say here, surprisingly enough, President Biden did not respond to my letter. Bummer. But still being able to think through what writing it had meant and what they were able to kind of crystallize for themselves in framing the information they had learned and kind of connecting it to a cause that they personally felt very passionate about. And to continue this idea of making connections outside of the classroom, towards the end of our term, something that we did as kind of an optional assignment and the literal definition of extra credit, where it goes beyond the expectations of a course, is to be able to offer feedback on and contribute to a live and working kind of community piece that was in the process of being produced. And Rachel mentioned in my introduction that I am collaborating with the JACL Detroit chapter and my co-curator Celeste Getter to put together a grassroots museum exhibit of Japanese American community in Detroit. And since we are in the process of doing this right now, I invite my students to be able to offer their own feedback and to have a role in what this exhibit might look like, and to be able to see sort of what these things look like when they are in process and in review and in that experimental phase, and to realize, you know, the information that they had and their ability to kind of bring it to something that was extant in the real world and that they could impact, even after just sort of at this point 9 weeks of instruction. And they did a really wonderful job, you know, engaging with the material, bringing their own kind of experiences to bear on what the information was, and offering corrections as well as, you know, reflections on how the material is being used and perceived. And this allowed them, I feel, a little bit of, you know, expertise and ownership in being able to then create their own final exhibits together, because they were able to see sort of that messy behind the green curtain feature of another exhibit, and to kind of trust in that process in their own exhibits that they were in the process of creating. And so this is some screenshots of one of those final exhibits. I wanted to share one where every group member had given permission to use their materials in this presentation. And what they wanted to do with their exhibit was to think about the topics that we had touched on in class and to do a little bit deeper dive into these questions of land and reparations and the ideology of home and belonging. And they did a very excellent job in kind of putting this together and wanting to make a website so that there would be lots of clicky things to click on, to quote their plan for this project, in order to have the interactive element. So if you are interested in looking at their website, I'm sure they would be absolutely overjoyed to share that with you. And so I'm actually coming up at the end of time here. There were a couple of other things that I wanted to speak to in terms of, you know, what the goals of this class were and where it went. So I will just kind of really quickly try and summarize that in order to lead us into our Q&A. And I think the important thing to really sit with, having had now about an hour of me talking at you about things that we might do in the classroom, is to really honor the idea that some students will take these questions and these premises further than others. And that is completely okay, right? There are students who are going to struggle very, very much with the kind of core premise of a class and the conversations that they might be engaged with you or with their peers might be quite different than what other students believe to be kind of the main goal of the class. And sometimes as an instructor, this might feel like a failing, or it's like, oh man, the student like really did not understand, you know, where we were trying to go with this. But it goes back to that idea of like, well, who's naming that goal, right? What are the learning goals of the class? What are the learning goals of the student? And what does that look like if we're trying to think about, you know, everyone being able to have their individual kind of experience of growth, right? And who's to say what timeline on which that experience will happen? And so some students will be talking very fluently about kind of ideologies of home belonging, and some students will still be having sort of the initial conversations that need to happen, and that will be able to ultimately kind of very, very minutely shift the door of kind of things that the student is able to conceptualize or willing to entertain. And being able to sit with that, I think, is really important, particularly in teaching a class that is kind of alleged to be teaching social justice at all, which to my mind is a topic that cannot happen only in a classroom and cannot kind of be taught in that way. It's sort of like how to do social justice is like how to do happiness or how to do crime, where part of it is something that you need to be kind of actively engaged in order to really realize the information that you are kind of putting together and experimenting with. And so I will go ahead and close there, but if there are people who are interested in talking more about some of the challenges that came up and how one might address things that happen, like for instance, if Israel and Palestine comes up in the final 4 minutes of class, and now you have 4 minutes to have that conversation before Friday afternoon rolls around, I am definitely more than happy to have those conversations. So thank you so much for listening, and I will go ahead and turn it over to our moderator for Q&A, and I'm excited to hear the kind of conversations that can come out of this.
Great, thank you so much, Mika, for that incredibly rich presentation. It's really inspiring, actually, on a number of levels. For me, I think as a teacher and as a learner, I think just seeing the level of care that you've spent in terms of even conceptualizing the course, to say nothing of the types of interactions that you're envisioning in the course, and then the different ways in which you're building in kind of space for reflection and also experimentation, I think is really powerful. So I was taking lots of notes on various tips and things that I'd like to cite with your permission, but I think it'd be really useful to think about kind of how to continue this kind of practice of getting students to be kind of critical thinkers, but then also to think seriously about kind of what type of activism or what type of they want to engage in, but also kind of what type of world they want to create, right? And what type of interactions they want to really foreground in their daily lives, to say nothing of it with their families or other people, or President Biden who did not write back to the letter or whomever. So as you've noticed, Sophie mentioned in the chat that you're welcome to put in questions to the Q&A function, and we'll get to some of those. So we'll start maybe with those. I saw one from, this is from Toshiki Masaki, who writes, realizing that you had no control over the mix of racial ethnic backgrounds of students, could you comment on how it might have impacted classroom discussions? And then he writes, I asked this because the most impactful workshop that I attended regarding racial issues was one with a critical mass of people of color participating, so they felt safe speaking freely.
Yeah, that's a really important question, and one that I think is particularly important in the context of K, which in as much as it tries really, really hard to be as kind of diverse a population as possible, is a small private liberal arts college in Western Michigan. And so the majority of the student body is white. And there are many students of color who do feel the kind of burden of that, right? Where there's a lot of conversations that they have been living and having for a really long time that many of their peers might not necessarily have the same experience with or be coming into with at the same place. At the same time, there are a lot of white students at K who are very much invested in and very kind of conversant in these ideas. And sometimes what can happen is there's a really strong desire, I guess, to be good, to be the good ally, to be the good accomplice, and to not want to mess that up in any way. Which kind of goes against this idea of experimentation and being allowed to make these mistakes. Where that sort of impacts classroom discussions, I think, is finding ways to have a classroom where mistakes are expected and permissible, but harm is not sort of being given a free pass, right? And so I think an example that I can bring up, I can't get too specific into it because some students did not actually fill out my permission survey for what I can speak to or not. But there was something in one of the final exhibits that during the gallery walk that the students did and looking at other groups' projects, a student got in touch with me and she's like, I feel really uncomfortable about the way that something is being framed in this exhibit. And the reason that it was so uncomfortable is because it was talking about quarantine and COVID and comparing it a little bit uncritically to Japanese American incarceration. And she's like, I am not Japanese American, but I am a student of color. And I feel like if someone had tried to kind of compare the pandemic and shelter in place to like chattel slavery, for instance, I would be really, really upset by that. And it's really difficult in that situation, right? Because at this point it was in asynchronous reflection. So there was no moment in class where you could kind of pause and have the conversation. And to leave that hanging definitely felt like there are some loose ends there. But I think in that situation, it behooves one to have a really strong sense of who all of your students are and to be in conversation with them at different kind of levels or in different modes. So I was able to tell that students like, yes, I definitely see the where this discomfort is coming from. And I can tell you that it is a conversation that has been in process over the course of the semester as this other student has been trying to work through these ideas and refine these ideas. And it's been a really steep learning curve. And then to be able to say, we are in that conversation, that process is happening, and I can let you know that, even if it is private. And then to also be able to tell the student that in my kind of public comments on all the exhibits, I will be able to kind of offer some potential reframings or some potential questions that aren't saying like, yo, student, like you can't say stuff like that, but does kind of make clear to the group outside of the private conversations that there are ways we might be able to think through these differently and to come to kind of this triangulation of different ways of interpreting or presenting this information.
Great, thank you for that. It also strikes me, I was thinking about that phrase that you mentioned, this notion of being charged with disclosure and how what that might mean for, let's say, students of color in a class, particularly at a predominantly white institution, for instance, who tend to be the ones who, particularly around discussions of race or discrimination, who were expected explicitly, in the worst cases, but also implicitly, to somehow disclose some notion of their experience or treatment in some ways for in this really often kind of gross way. And so thinking about how, in this case, the discussion of the Japanese American experience with incarceration might actually potentially allow for more empathy around some of those things is just kind of an interesting thing to consider as well. Yeah. So we have a bunch more questions, and so I want to try to get through some more of these. So one is a compliment that then leads into a question. So this is Jessica Fernandez de Lara Harada, who says, thank you so much for your talk. It is an excellent course design, and I'm very inspired by it. And then she asks, she says, it seems that an important component of your teaching philosophy is to foster connections between different histories, racisms, and experiences. How do you create a balance between exploring the history of Japanese Americans' incarceration and connecting it with other related histories of race and racism in your course? I might be wrong, but I have the impression that Japanese Americans' incarceration history is marginal in the US. How can you make it central to explore both the roots and legacies on which it is built?
Yeah, I think that's also just a super important question, because it's one that I believe the class really led with, in that walking into this class, there was not a single student who had any kind of strong knowledge or information of Japanese American incarceration. We did an activity where it's like, all right, what do we know, or what might we feel like we now need to know? And there were students who had never heard of it, period. There were students who had heard the paragraph about it in terms of their US history books. It was like, this is a thing that happened, but mostly Nazis. And then there were people who came from areas, I think, that had a little bit more experience with that information. Like, I had a student from Chicago who kind of knew a little bit about the fact that there's a large Japanese population in her city, comparatively speaking. And so to address that question was really to make it as explicit as possible in the class. And it's like, all right, if our topic is Japanese American incarceration, which might feel a little bit like niche, how can we begin making these connections? Where do those connections proceed from? What structures are we looking at to kind of go back to this idea of naming structures of inequality as kind of the groundwork of anti-racist pedagogy? And to think about, like, in what ways do we see in these narratives that we're exploring these connections being either implicitly or explicitly made? And what are the structures that seem, you know, similar or in relation in these particular circumstances? And so in one of our early texts, Displacement by Kiku Hughes, the main character is living through the 2016 election. And so her character is watching her mom watch the news about the Muslim travel ban and the border wall and all of these different things. And the kind of conceit of this graphic novel is that the main character gets kind of involuntarily displaced back into time, where she is living in the incarceration camp with her grandmother. And so that what that text is doing is placing these kind of narratives in conversation with another through the motif of time travel, right? Where she is experiencing the incarceration, but then back at home is experiencing kind of this news cycle. And where it goes in the novel is sort of a brief conversation with her mother and talking about her mother's growing up when she was Kiku's age, and connecting it to the civil rights movement in the 1960s, and how kind of Asian Americans were being presented as a model minority in that situation, and having kind of Kiku begin to kind of thread these things together. And in that text, it was really kind of more inference than making these explicit connections in a very kind of historical, theoretical way, but it began to plant that seed that we could then move with through other texts that were really more explicitly about naming those situations. And I think where that really came through was talking about the poetry of Mitsue Yamada a couple of weeks later, where the poems were kind of thinking through the incarceration, thinking through the space of the desert. But because we were also talking about the fact that camps were situated on native land and had read kind of historical documents about that, students were able to see that the connections were not just because they were similar, but because they were in fact part of this very literal system that was taking place. And so the ability to make these connections really came kind of gradually throughout the term. And by the end of the term, we we spent a week talking a lot more generally than I was expecting. Like my game plan was to talk about HR 40, which is talking about research into reparations for US slavery. But because of the nature of spring and the fact there's just a lot going on in the world, we ended up having it was not specific to HR 40, but it was not a general conversation in the sense that we were talking about what it means to foster repair, what reparation means, what the work of kind of restorative justice might be. And a student after that conversation was like, I feel like this conversation happened at the exact right point of this class, where we're thinking about these sorts of specificities, but now trying to figure out how to pull it all together and how to kind of make these meaningful connections across all these different pieces that we have learned.
Thank you for thinking through that. And I think it's, I'm clearly not alone in being really impressed by the way you're putting things together, but it's also helpful to hear about kind of how the real world, not just in the framing of kind of COVID and so forth, but actually intrudes or, you know, helps in some ways to make these connections, so that there's the way in which maybe art imitates life in terms of some of these things, for better and for worse. Yeah. So we have some more questions I'd like to get to. One is, I think, a relatively famous last words, relatively straightforward one. This is from Lisa Wexler, who asks, what were some of the trickiest student comments or conversations you navigated in that space?
Oh, man. So
two is fine.
There is that dust up with thinking about kind of how to articulate one's relationship to a pandemic that one is living and connected to a history, and in what ways that might be a useful move and what ways that might require a lot more kind of analytical work in order to make that work. But I think probably the one that made me the most worried was the conversation where literally 4 minutes left of class, I was like, this reminds me of Israel and Palestine. And then we had 4 minutes to try and have that conversation and make those connections, which of course there's no expectation that that would happen. But I also did not want to leave that hanging, right? And to have it be just like, well, that's not related to this course, so we will not talk about it. Because of course it's related to this course. It's called Reading the World Social Justice and is about displacement and settler colonialism. And the student who had brought it up had already felt a little bit timid, I think, about saying it. She's like, well, this isn't really on topic, but it's something that I'm thinking about. I was like, no, this is very on topic. Don't you worry. But to figure out then what to do when you have 4 minutes for this conversation, that my personal feeling is that I cannot responsibly teach about Israel and Palestine. I am too much in the process of learning to be able to kind of, again, responsibly moderate that discussion. So what I decided that I could do was ensure that the student knew that we had been listening to her and that the other student who chimed in afterwards had been listening to them. And so actually I have some slides for this. So I will real quick return to these slides so that we have a brief visual here. I won't put it in presentation mode. We can be a little bit more informal about this. But essentially what I decided I wanted to do first was to find some kind of low stakes entry points for students who, because there was, like Toshiki mentioned in the class, a lot of different stages at which people were kind of engaging with this information. Some of whom were actively organizing on campus and organizing vigils, and some of whom were not entirely clear what it was. And so in choosing these entry points, I wanted to choose things that were, you know, had a low barrier to entry and that were easy, because it was week 9. but also that were specifically connected to the points that students had brought up, so that there was this idea that it was coming from the conversation that we had started in those 4 minutes, and that it was personal in that way. And it was not just some random information, but was connected to things that students themselves had made in class. So I shared something that shared an analogy similar to what a student had mentioned and brought up. And I shared a thread of recommendations on Twitter that was similar to what another student had brought up in terms of thinking about it with regard to land and settler colonialism and the environment in particular. And so there was that sort of intimate resonance, I think, with what I was sharing, and it did not feel like random information that we were just sort of gonna slap onto our LMS and move on from. And to make very clear that there was space for those conversations for those who chose to engage in it. And we weren't gonna make anyone kind of explain this to the class or talk about things that they kind of preferred to do in their own spaces. But I think the invitation to have that space available was really important, because students did end up continuing that conversation and replying to letters that had brought it up. I had a student who wrote to her mother about their relatives in Palestine, and another student too was kind of entering into that conversation by connecting it to ideas that we had talked about in class. And another student who was connecting it to a guest speaker who had come to talk to us and was talking about, her relationship to the history of incarceration within her family and contending with this idea of many Japanese Americans sort of going into the camps without what we would traditionally call kind of like protest or resistance in the present day, and contending with that. And so this student was able to think through that conversation and use it to process some of what she was feeling in terms of her own kind of frustrations, in terms of kind of what protests might have looked like in the past and what the expectations might be different now, or what forms that these things take and the multiplicity of those forms. And then the final project for this class was very open-ended. So a student had the opportunity to kind of continue working with these ideas and building these connections, and knowing that there would be people who would read and respond to this idea without it being sort of left up in the rafters of whatever Friday that had happened to be for those 4 minutes.
Oh, great. Thank you for sharing that. And I think that that's really useful. I mean, it strikes me that for maybe several of the educators on the in the Zoom meeting, that trying to figure out how to deal with so-called difficult topics, even within a class that's dedicated to dealing with arguably a difficult topic, is hard. And so just having a sense of activities or just ways of dealing with these things, I think is super useful. There's a couple other questions. We have a little bit of time. I think maybe I'll try this one, because I think it relates to what you were just talking about. So one is, this is from our Toyota visiting professor, Hua Jixin, who says, thank you for sharing your thoughtful pedagogical philosophy and approach. I learned so much from you. If possible, would you talk about your thoughts and approach to trigger warnings? Do you give one? Or if so, under what circumstance you give, and what kind of warning do you give?
Yeah, so I do give trigger warnings. I think for this class, they tended to be a little bit more general, in the sense that's like, well, this is the topic we'll be talking about all quarter. And a lot of these different sorts of interventions are going to touch on similar ideas. And so to be prepared for that. But then there were more specific ones that I would offer. For instance, there was a podcast episode that talked about the shooting of an unarmed man in an incarceration camp, and was making connections to the shooting of unarmed, to police shootings in general, and that sort of dynamic. And this of course happened at the exact time that the Chauvin trial was going on, so it was something very much in the immediate reality of where this class was taking place. And so it did offer specific warning for that. I think most of the warnings that I offered this term were actually in my other class. but my general policy is that I will offer them for things that I know to be really charged and really difficult subjects for many. I will typically put them on the schedule on our LMS to be like, hey, this reading includes this, just so you know. And then offer kind of a reminder at the beginning of class, be like, so as we enter into this conversation, people have different ways of having experienced these ideas or to be thinking about these ideas, and to be kind of mindful of that as we discuss them. And if you are someone who needs to step away from class at any time, it is always an option regardless of what we're talking about, but to have that reminder sort of in the room. I also tend to say, like, these are the things I tend to warn for so that you have this idea and can be prepared for it. If you need something more specific, please let me know. Like, I had a student last quarter in a class that was not this one, but we were watching Thelma and Louise, which opens with an attempted rape. And I had mentioned that in the trigger warning, and she's like, all right, so I checked the like website that talks about films and stuff, but I can't find the timestamp for that scene. I know I can't watch it, but I wanna make sure that I can watch as much of the movie before and after that scene as possible. Can you give me the timestamp? I was like, why, certainly, student. I can indeed give you that timestamp. And so that was a situation where she knew she could not watch that very visual footage and gave herself permission to skip it. She did not skip the discussion and she did not skip the movie entirely. And so being able to kind of work with that on a case by case basis, and for students to know that they are welcome to kind of express what they know they can and can't handle at a given moment. And I think that openness is really important. And the way that that has typically happened in Zoom is that people will just sort of step away from their computer, and sometimes they'll let me know afterwards, sometimes they won't, and it's fine with me either way. But to know that that is a practice that is available to them, I think actually is really important. Similarly, I did have a conversation with a student who's like, I don't understand why we have these warnings at all. They really bother me because people should just like deal with it. And so we had also a conversation about that and like the reasoning behind why I include them. It's like, well, even if it is not something that's triggering to me or something that might not appear triggering to you, there are people for whom that is genuinely going to kind of have a psychological, physiological response.
Yeah, great. Thank you so, so much for all of those incredibly thoughtful answers after really stimulating and in fact inspiring, I'd say, presentation, Mika. So we're at time at this point, but I'd invite all of the folks here. Did you want to maybe just say something about the Exile to Motown exhibit? I believe you said it was starting, is it July 17th it's opening? Is this correct?
Yeah, absolutely. So Exile to Motown, which bears the prouder visions of my students among many others, is an exhibit, a grassroots exhibit of Japanese American community in Detroit that has been put together by an innumerable number of people over the past couple of decades in collecting oral histories, and now in kind of pairing those with some visual and historical narrative that me and my co-curator Celeste Gettert have been working on with the Detroit Historical Museum. And so that will open on July 17th this year and will run through October 3rd. So, and the museum's COVID protocols are quite good. So depending on your level of comfort, we really hope that you will be able to join us in Southeast Michigan.
That's great. Thank you so much. So thank you so much again. please feel free. This as is mentioned in the chat, there's a link to the exhibit, as well as if you would like to share this amazing presentation with friends, colleagues, students, family, etc. Note that it'll be up in the coming days on the CGS website and the YouTube site, so you can check it out there. And please join me in thanking the amazing Dr. Mika Kennedy for this really wonderful presentation. Thank you so much. All right, take care, everybody.